I'm from ABARES, the Economic and Science Research Division in the Department of Agriculture, Water and the Environment. And I'm here to talk about how national pest and weed management data sets help understand change at the landscape scale by reporting some results from two national surveys conducted by ABARES in 2016 and 2019 of agricultural land managers about their on-farm pest and weed management. And I would like to acknowledge as well that this series of pest and weed surveys has been enabled by funding from the Department of Agriculture, Water and Environment through the established Pest, Animals and Weeds Management Pipeline Program and the previous agricultural white paper. So we all know that pest animals pose a serious problem for agricultural systems and the environment, and there's significant collective effort and on-ground activities to manage established pests, including the contribution by landholders and a whole range of NRM, land care and pest management groups across the landscape. But the question I wanted to pose is, how will we know how effective these investments and collective efforts are? A number of useful data sets exist that can help, but there's need for a regular national data collection on agricultural landholders' pest and weed management activities. Landholders are definitely a key group with responsibility for managing pests and weeds on private land. So to enable the Department of Agriculture, Water and the Environment to evaluate outcomes of all these collective efforts, a national survey of agricultural land managers was undertaken by ABARES in 2016 to collect this data, and we followed up with a second pest and weed management survey in 2019, and there's also plans for a third survey in 2022. So the pest and weed survey series is also intended to provide a national data set that can be used by all stakeholders who are interested in seeing what on-ground activities, impacts and efforts are achieving in the pest management space. So I won't dwell too much on the survey design, except to say that we surveyed 6,500 farmers in 2016. And then when we ran the survey again in 2019, the response was very encouraging, with over 8,000 responses from across Australia. So to get regionally accurate information, the sampling was designed to enable reporting at the national, state and NRM regional level for the 53 regions across Australia. The methodology was robust, and it's all there in the 2019 report, which we've just released. So if you have any questions about the methods, please contact me out of session. But with the time available in this presentation, I just wanted to show you some of the outcomes of the latest 2019 survey. So I'll pick a couple of highlights from the survey, focusing on vertebrate pest animals, to explain the value of the national data set for looking at landscape level change. So we asked respondents about problems they're having with a range of vertebrate pests on their properties. The first two charts show that the proportion of respondents who reported a problem with 12 different pest animal species on their properties. The major problems most commonly reported by more than 30% of land managers across Australia in 2016 and 2019 were with native animals. And the chart to the right shows the percentage point change in problems, both major and minor, that were reported by land managers between the surveys for those same 12 pest animal species. And so what we can see is that pest problems have increased nationally for a number of species such as feral deer, feral pigs, and native animals and birds. And it's really interesting to see that there's been a decrease in problems with species such as foxes and rabbits. Some of these changes are pretty large, and we've actually looked at whether they're statistically significant, and all of the percentage changes that I've noted there in bold are statistically significant changes. The plague of mice that's currently infesting crops in New South Wales and other parts of eastern Australia was not really picked up in the 2019 survey, just because of the timing. It was actually in the field in mid-2019 before the mouse plague took hold. The value in the data is that this could be disaggregated to see differences in pest problems across NRM regions to get more detail on where these changes happened in the landscape. So just to show you the kinds of landscape scale analysis we've done on these surveys, this map here shows the changes in feral deer problems for the period between 2016 and 2019. So the regions in orange mean that the problem is increasing, and the blue regions show a decreasing problem with feral deer over the 3 years. And I just chose this species because it's actually quite interesting what changes were happening with it. This shows clearly how the changes over 3 years vary a lot across the nation. The feral deer problem has intensified, particularly around Victoria's northeast region and into New South Wales. shown by the dark orange colours, where there was an increase of between about 9 and 12 percentage points in reports of problems with feral deer. And we can also see an increasing trend in problems with feral deer in Western Victoria and also reaching up into South Australia in our own regions. We've done this analysis of change for all 12 vertebrate pest groups, and you can jump onto our Tableau dashboard and explore them for yourself. And I'll give you that web link to that dashboard in the last slide. So this chart here shows reports of all types of impacts on agricultural properties caused by feral animals in orange bars, and the native animals are shown in the lighter bars. This had increased in 2019 compared with 3 years before. So we do have to take into account the fact that 2016 had substantially higher rainfall, while 2019 was actually a drought year. And these factors affect quite a lot the impact numbers and the distribution of pest animals. So of those farmers with pest animal problems in 2016, about 40% of them said they had experienced crop damage or decreased production impacts from feral animals. And 60% of farmers said that native animals and birds had caused crop damage. And then 3 years later in 2019, reports of feral and native animals damaging property and infrastructure was up by 15 percentage points. And then reports of damage to crops by feral and native animals were up by 14 percentage points. And farmers were also concerned about the increased risk of disease spread by vertebrate pest animals, which was up by 10 percentage points between the surveys. And the changes in pest species impacts on agricultural properties nationally seems to be reflected in the comments that people made on the recently arrived or emerging pest species, which was a new question in our 2019 survey. The most commonly reported new arrivals were deer and native animals, followed by feral pigs and wild dogs. And this suggests that there are changes in where species are moving through the landscape. And these are quite interesting findings from both a policy perspective and for farmers as well. And this chart here looks at the changes in types of pest animal controls used on agricultural properties. About 75% of respondents reported that they had undertaken activities to manage pest-related problems in 2016 and 2019. And of those who were actively managing a pest on their property, you can see that there was a small increase in land managers reporting the use of aerial baiting and trapping activity, and ground baiting and shooting stayed fairly steady. We can see an interesting small increase in the use of biological controls since 2016, perhaps as biological controls have become more available over that time. And there's also a small increase we can see over 3 years in the use of exclusion fencing or netting by land managers. And local pest and weed management groups are a really important way that land managers are pulling together to improve effective management. And we can see that the rates of group membership from this chart nationally hasn't changed that much over the two surveys, despite the increased reports of impacts. And it stayed around 10% of land managers who said that they were a member of a group. So it is good to see that land managers are continuing to support each other in coordinated pest and weed management at the landscape level. And in terms of participation in local pest and weed management activities and programs run by different service providers, we can see that the rates of participation in activities nationally has gone down quite a bit over the 3 years, from 36% in 2016 down to about 31% of land managers in 2019 who said that they participated in local activities for pest and weed management. Unfortunately, we can't disaggregate activities relating to pest animals from weed-related activities, as it was all just one question in the survey. But some of this reduction in activity could be explained by the reduced overall vegetation growth, including weeds, and the activities needed to control them due to the severe and prolonged drought across much of the country in 2019. We've also drilled down to see where the change in participation in activities and programs have happened. So this map here shows the changes by region. The red colour is where a lower proportion of land managers are participating in activities, and the green areas are where there's been increases in participation. And we can see that the rates of participation have generally dropped over the 3 years between 1 and 30 or 40 percentage points in some regions. Although land manager participation in local pest and weed management activities and programs is down, the proportion of respondents in groups that have action plans in place for managing pest animals has increased by about 10 percentage points over the 3 years since 2016, suggesting that the groups are much more organised and targeted in the way that they're doing pest management. So the value of national data sets is that they give insights into pest and weed problems and management at the regional level. And this can definitely help a range of stakeholders plan and manage these threats better. So today I focus more on pest animal management, but we've also got a lot of information about invertebrate pests and weed management data at the regional level, which we've analysed. The overview I gave showed that there've been real impacts with higher reports of pest animals, but there's also steady participation rates in pest management groups and better pest management net plan coverage, which suggests that land managers are responding with collective action at the landscape level. So the data can be used to track changes over time in pest and weed problems and management activities, particularly with the repeat of the survey in 2019 and the plan that we have to run another survey in 2022. And it can also contribute to our ability to evaluate what difference the collective investments and efforts by all stakeholders have made over the years. And we're always exploring better ways to communicate our research to make it more accessible to a wider group of stakeholders who might find it useful, particularly for understanding pest animal and weed problems and management responses spatially across Australia. And to realise the full value of this national data set, we've updated the Tableau dashboard to include the 2016 and 2019 data, along with an updated survey report on the ABARES website where you can explore the maps and the survey data for yourself and compare the results across NRM regions. And we've done a lot more analysis of trends in pest and weed problems, impacts and management between 2016 and 2019. And we've put all this into the new dashboard and report too. So you can find the full report and Tableau dashboard at this link on the screen. And if you've got any thoughts on how you'd like to use this data, we'd be really interested to hear about this. So please feel free to contact me about it afterwards. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you, Nyree, for that presentation. We've got 1 minute for questions. If people would like to pop it into the live Q&A chat, that would be great. In the meantime, I'll ask a question that I've got here. I guess the utility of such a data will increase the more it's done over time. What are the plans in terms of repeating this survey into the future?
Yes, so we, I think you're right. You know, this kind of thing does become more interesting the more points in time at which you can measure the changes. And certainly, yeah, the trends are quite interesting. We've been in discussions with the Department of Agriculture, Water and the Environment, the Established Pests and Weeds section there, and I think they're interested in another survey in 2022 just to make sure that we do continue to collect updated information. And it's, and I think that's really encouraging, and we're preparing to look at the design of the survey, the sampling, the survey questions. We're just going to refresh and think about refining some of the questions in the survey. So, yeah, those discussions are ongoing at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Nyree. And I've got a people question for you, according to the theme of today, I suppose. Can you elaborate a bit on some of the ways that you see landholders and community groups using and engaging directly with this research now and into the future?
Yeah, that's interesting, and I guess we have had quite a lot of inquiries about what is happening in, you know, my NRM region from different groups, NRM groups, and also state and territory governments as well. And this is partly the reason why we developed the Tableau dashboard, so that that those groups could actually look up the results for their region, like what management controls people are using, agricultural land managers are using, and group activity, participation in groups and activities for pest and weed management in their regions. So there's been quite a lot of back and forth about that, and also quite a lot of people have visited the Tableau dashboard, so I guess they're pulling out results that might be relevant for planning their activities in their regions.
Okay. Yeah, thanks very much, Nyree.